Hi. In the first two videos, we talked about the principal idea of multidimensional time. In the third video, we presented six ideas and outlined the project to explore a generative rather than a descriptive approach to physics, looking for a formula that generates our observed world rather than a collection of formulae that describe its behavior. We listed these four items required for that: a number system to describe values and coordinates, a structure defining the predecessors of each point, an initial condition, and a generating formula that calculates the value at each point depending on the values of its predecessors. In video 4, we presented a number system that ticks off the first requirement on that list. Today we'll talk about item 2, the structure, and also answer a question that I'm sure many of you have after watching the previous videos, namely, how many time dimensions there are exactly? 2, 3, or more? The first thing to note is that the time dimensions don't all have to have the same complexity gradient. In the first video, we used the image of marbles rolling down a cone to visualize timelines with 2 time dimensions. If the time dimensions have the same complexity gradient, then the overall steepest complexity gradient, our timeline, is exactly diagonally between them. Now let's consider the case where one time dimension produces a shallower complexity gradient than the other one. Our cone now looks like this. The path of our marble now goes mainly down one of the time dimensions and is only slightly deflected by the other. Now, if one of the time dimensions is billions of times shallower than the other, then you can approximate the world with a lower number of time dimensions. Here are snapshots of the world with time running down. Now, in a sideways in time direction, we have copies of the timeline with much smaller differences left to right than up to down, meaning a shallower complexity gradient. In any dimension with an imperceptible complexity gradient, in effect, all the timelines are just replicated, so you may as well just ignore the extra ones. For our basic grid of immediate predecessors, we'll reuse the same structure used to define multidimensional numbers in the first place. These are multidimensional numbers with integer coordinates. This implies that time and space are not only multidimensional, but also discrete. This feels weird because it implies that there are absolute x, y, z directions in space. A very unrelativistic point of view. This places the requirement of rotational invariance on the generating equation that we're ultimately looking for. Let's talk about how we rotate solid bodies in space with integer x, y, and z coordinates. A geometric shape with its corner points at integer coordinates will no longer be at integer coordinates when rotated by angles that are not multiples of 90 degrees. Although we do need to bear in mind that in reality there's no such thing as a rigid body. Everything is mostly nothing. Solid matter consists of molecules and atoms that are far apart from each other and in constant motion. So is this the answer? That the small discrepancies when rotating an object with integer coordinates are not noticeable the same way as you'd rotate a digital photograph on your computer using image processing software? No, that's not it. How about uncertainty? No, that has nothing to do with it either. This works at much bigger scales and is due to the observer's mind states, as explained in the first two videos. Integer space coordinates do not necessarily imply that particles can only leap from one grid position to the next, like the stable patterns in Conway's Game of Life. Although the vectors are only defined on the discrete grid, it doesn't mean that the particles can't have locations with continuous values. Take a look at this. The vectors are only defined at the grid points, but the center that's well around can be in between. This is just a two-dimensional example visualization of a pattern. Some of the particles we're looking for are the 6D equivalent of helixes, but we'll talk about that in the next video. The well-defined particle position is merely the center of the pattern. On the other hand, having discrete spacetime is not as strange as it first seems. It is well known that there is a smallest time and space unit called Planck time and Planck length. Traditionally, physics considers these as the smallest meaningful intervals, but has shied away from declaring space and time to be quantized. Back to the question of how many time dimensions. We use the number system defined in video 4 and pick a generating function that produces a hierarchy of complexity gradients. So we're talking about a nested structure of progressively weaker time dimensions. At order 4, we have 6 time dimensions. 3 have no complexity gradient, so we call them space dimensions, and 3 have a strong complexity gradient, so we call these time dimensions. In the next video, we'll talk about the types of stable patterns to expect. Let's call this a six-dimensional spacetime. At order 5, we have 5 sets of these 6 dimensions. The complexity gradient is much, much shallower, so the states of the spaces sideways in time of the new 5 dimensions change a lot more slowly than within each of the 6-dimensional subspacetimes. At order 7, we have 7 sets of these 30-dimensional spacetimes. The complexity gradient is so shallow that to us the extra 7 dimensions appear identical, so we only experience 30 dimensions. These hierarchy of time dimensions have a quantifiable effect on the strengths of the fundamental forces that we experience, but this will be the subject of its own video. So, is 3D space organized in a cubic grid structure? Almost, but not quite. We will conclude this video by showing the order 4 structure of 6-dimensional spacetime. A quick recap from previous videos. Let's start by exploring a 2-dimensional cellular automaton, where the state of each cell depends on the state of 2 predecessors. Here the value of the cell at position P depends on the value of the cell at P-1 and the one at P-I. The cells at the edge, here in grey, only have 1 predecessor. Eventually everything leads back to the cell at the origin, as usual in pale yellow. So the value of the cells in the middle is calculated by a function that takes 2 arguments, the values of the 2 immediate predecessors. The grey cells at the edges are defined by a function with a single argument. The cell at the origin is the initial condition. As we saw before, with a function v that shows increasing complexity, you can look at it as having space and time dimensions. Here again, with time running downwards. Let's call the mathematical coordinate system rectangular coordinates and the other space-time coordinates. In rectangular coordinates, a point P is a complex number a plus ib. In space-time coordinates, this would be x, t. We can easily convert between them. Let's now move on to 6 dimensions made by order 4 rotational numbers. The general form of a 6-dimensional number is this. These are rectangular coordinates. In space-time coordinates, we can call this xyz, tx, ty, tz, so we have 3 space and 3 time dimensions. Converting between these is easy. And visualization of a 6-dimensional spacetime is not as hard as you may think. Here's our 2D grid first. The points form a checkerboard pattern shown in blue and red here. Each blue point depends on 2 red points, and each red point depends on 2 blue points. When looked at in space-time coordinates, these colors form layers, and you can see that you need to go back 2 time steps before you find a point at the same space coordinates. A similar thing happens in the 6-dimensional case. Here is a space with xyz coordinates. We have checkerboard colored the points also in red and blue. We have 2 types of space structures, one where only the red points are valid and one where only the blue points are. Very disappointingly, this is not called quincunxonium, but body-centered cubic by crystallography, which gives names to the different lattice types. If we represent the whole space by a cube of the corresponding color, we can also visualize the time dimensions. Here they're shown as tx, ty, tz. Each cube represents a whole 3-dimensional space with the type of its structure indicated by the color. The dominant timeline is on the diagonal. You see that the first cube on the diagonal is of the opposite color. The first time you get a point at exactly the same space coordinate on the dominant timeline is after 6 time steps. It's worth noting that the timeline passing through the origin is just one of many parallel timelines. Here are some others. In the next video, we'll talk about how stable patterns in this structure could look.